Gentlemen, bass players around the world, bass players around the country, bass players, Detroit bass players, we got ourselves a a legend in the house. Tell us your name, sir.
My name is Eddie Watkins Jr.
A Detroit bass player, Eddie Watkins Jr. is hanging out with us in the BASSmint. That's BASSmint. And we're going to do an interview with this fine bass player, man. And I'm looking forward to asking you some many questions, man. I'm Big Ive behind the camera, where I should be. Wow. Also, we got another bass player in the house. Tell us your name, sir.
Cheyenne Chevy DiLorenzo, but y'all can just call me Chevy. It's kind of like the whole Prince thing, you know what I'm saying? It's just Prince, just Chevy.
You know what I mean? Okay, and he's not, well, he's a Detroit bass player now.
Yeah.
But he's a New York bass player, right?
That's right. New York, Strong Island, Long Island, all that good stuff.
And we're going to be doing an interview with him, man. I can't wait to get your take on...
It's not going to sound nothing like that.
I can't wait to get your take on Detroit and New York. Also hanging out with us is none other than, tell us your name, sir.
Reginald Canty.
Another Detroit bass player. Our gracious host who allows us to use the BASSmint. Appreciate it, bro. Thanks for allowing this to happen, man. Who else we got in the house with us?
A sister of a bass player.
All right, so you know a little bit about bass, too. Can you tell us your name?
My name is Marlito Watkins.
How you doing, Marlito?
I'm doing great.
Welcome to the BASSmint. Eddie, man, ever since I got back to Detroit, man, your name keep popping up. And a list of bass players, I'm only gonna name a couple of them. Mm-hmm. Forgive me, the other guys I don't name. That's because I'm forgetful. But Tony Newton, mm-hmm. James Jamerson, mm-hmm. Bob Babbitt. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna just stop there for right now. Detroit bass players, mm-hmm. back in the day, right. They got to do a lot of stuff, and your name comes up right with theirs when it comes to Motown. Mm-hmm. But before we talk about that, man, I got a question I'd like to ask you. When did you start playing the bass, and why?
Oh, I started playing the bass at 13 years old, and the reason why is because I had already played piano, you know, I had piano lessons and stuff, and I had done the whole piano thing with recitals and all that kind of stuff, but I was playing in a band and playing organ, mm-hmm. and I wasn't really conscious of what a bass guitar was, you know. I knew that I always loved it. I knew that, like, you know, my folks had this big stereo, huge stereo. Mm-hmm. And I remember, like, the bass in it was just, like, so big, and it would, like, rattle the floor. And then there was something about that that I absolutely loved, you know. So when I got in this band, it was a bass player. And when he started playing the bass, I wanted to play that instrument instead of the keyboard. And it was, like, instant. Because when I heard it, I fell in love with it. It was, like, that's what I was meant to play, you know. Mm-hmm. So I ended up, like, kind of taking the guy's bass without his permission, and I took it home and messed around with it a little bit. But, you know, I had I told my dad, I said, you know, Dad, I want to play bass now. He said, you know, like, okay, cool, play bass then, you know. And I said, but I need a bass. He said, get a bass. And, you know, his point was that they had already bought me an organ. And that was kind of like it. So if whatever you want, you got to get it yourself. So the only job I ever had outside of music was a paper route. Mm-hmm. When I was like 13.
Free press or Detroit North?
Just free press, yeah. And I had a paper route, and I kept the paper route long enough to buy a bass.
Sound familiar.
And my first bass was a Fender Precision, Candy Apple Red. It was in the box in a case. Out Mount Clemens, and I found it in Trading Times. Amazing.
Wow.
I got there, and I said, I thought it was a new bass, you know. And he just brought out a box. So I said, okay. So I got to open the box. And back then, it came with a case, with a strap, with cords, and with cleaners and wrenches and everything back then, you know. So I got that Candy Apple bass, red bass, and I took that bass with me everywhere I slept with that bass. I couldn't afford an amp. but there was wood paneling in my room, so I put it up against the wall like this, and this is how I practice like this. You know, it went through the wall. But the point of it is like I was so in love with the instrument that I took the bass with me to school. I didn't have nothing to do with it, but right. I just wanted everybody in the world to know I was a bass player.
It was sick, but it was my sick,
and I just played it every chance I got, you know. But my first experience with bass was with Ernie Rogers. Ernie Rogers put the first bass in my hand. It was an upright bass. Wow. At Miller Junior High.
That is awesome. Before I forget, where is that bass now? That Fender, Candy Apple Red Fender.
It disappeared in Chicago somewhere. American Airlines.
Wow.
Yeah.
Another victim that happens. I'm thinking it's a place right now that's like 1,000 bases sitting there because it happens.
It's a great guy somewhere.
It happens all the time.
And they actually replaced it for the full value.
Oh, that's cool.
That was back in the 70s. Yeah, back in the 70s.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and when did you start hitting with some other musicians as a bass player? Did you want to name that bass player that you borrowed his bass?
I don't even remember his name.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, well, when did you start hitting as a bass player with other musicians?
I got a gig when I was, I think, 14, but I had to join the union. It was with a guy named Johnny Trafton. It was with the Johnny Trafton Orchestra. And we played at Park and Recreations that summer. That I was 14 years old. And that's where I met Wild Bill Moore, Teddy Harris, Sam Sanders, Beans Bowles, and all those guys used to play in the in Johnny Trafton's band, right?
Mm-hmm.
From playing with those guys, it was a novelty having a 14-year-old bass player, but I couldn't do much at the time because I wasn't old enough, but Harold McKinney is the guy that actually, when he started the new Metropolitan Arts Complex downtown, and he was running that thing, that was where it was just the most incredible thing where you could go and take lessons, you could check out instruments. Ed Pickens, Beans Bowles, Teddy Harris, all of those guys were some of the teachers that were there.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a most incredible experience because I could take the bus after I got out of school and you'd go down there and stay until the place closed,
mm-hmm.
You know. That's where I met James Jameson. He was there rehearsing with Smokey Robinson and the Miracles because they would rehearse there, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Paul Reiser, I knew Paul Reiser because me and Ricky were like best friends back in high school, Ricky Lawson. So I knew Paul Reiser, so Paul introduced me to Jameson, you know. So, I was just fascinated. I just was watching this guy play. It was just with one finger.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I asked him, would he give me lessons? He said, I don't give lessons. You know, but he did give me a couple of pointers, and he actually showed me how he played I Was Made to Love Her with the one finger, you know. Mm-hmm. And I tried to do that. It just didn't work for me because that's not my style, you know. But he showed me that it could be done, you know. And but my experience with Jameson was mostly from afar, like a lot of people, but I did have a chance to kind of talk with him a few times, you know. And but I need to digress a little bit. The guy that that was the second biggest inspiration to me besides Jameson was Tony Newton, because Tony Newton had that Motown sound. Man, it was him and Jameson. Mm-hmm. Those cats had that sound, and the next cat that came back that really had that sound was Michael Henderson, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And these were the guys that I idolized when I was coming up. I remember Ernie Rogers taking me to a Motown review at the Fox when I was still in junior high school. Michael Henderson couldn't have been 16 or 17 years old, mm-hmm. You know, and he was playing behind the spinners or somebody, and man, Michael Henderson, he got down, man. I mean, the cat, man, he's got all of that Motown stuff, but a little bit extra. He's got some of that other stuff, you know, and he showed that up in Miles with Miles Davis, you know. Mm-hmm. And not only that, being a a composer and a singer and arranger and stuff. You know, he brought another thing to the bass, but only with that whole Motown sound. You know,
right. Just acknowledge this man right here currently plays second base with Michael Henderson.
Oh, just shit, man. Yep. Yeah. That's a legend right there, man.
Yep.
We had a show, it got postponed in Canada. All Boca's just postponed.
Yeah.
That Masonic was supposed to be on the 5th, supposed to be this past Sunday. So I'm hoping they get that together. But I'd love to do that in front of a whole town.
Yeah.
And get that kind of season, get what you guys been feeling all this time.
Yeah, it's awesome, man. You know,
you guys was like teenagers playing with the cats. I was like, I done pulled out my hair, man. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, I wasn't even old enough, you know, because I used to play the 20 grand. I was like 17.
We used to dream about them kind of games.
Yeah, but that's the Dells. I played bass with the Dells from behind stage, you know, at the 20 grand. Let me see, who else did I play with? I played with the Undisputed Truth at the 20 grand. Hamilton Bohannon with Leroy Emanuel and Wawa Watson and Ray Parker Jr. Mm-hmm. That was the Bohannon band.
Right.
You know.
See, I was too young to get it. I was too young for the. You know, our parents was real careful after 67. After 67.
Yeah.
I think I was like 17 then, something like that, 15.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I had to sneak down to take my lessons down at Hewitt's.
But there's milestones in your life that you remember. You know, when we were living on the east side on Hendrix, I had a buddy named Emmett Smith. You know, we went to Miller together. You know, he's a guitar player. And when James Brown came, that was back to, when he had the Cobo Hall. James Brown was in town, and he said, you know, we need to go see James Brown. I said, yeah, of course we need to see James Brown, but I can't get out the house. You know, so we actually. He came and we snuck out. I was in bed. We snuck out. We took the bus downtown to Cobo Hall and snuck in the back and actually got in.
Wow.
We got in. And once we got in there, we ended up on the floor, right? And I ended up right in front of the stage. By that time, people had started rushing the stage at Cobo, right?
Mm-hmm.
So me and Emmett, we were right there in front of the stage watching James Brown.
Mm-hmm.
That was like a life-changing moment. Because that was the tightest band I had ever heard in my life. And live. So then it occurred to me that that's the kind of player I wanted to be. I wanted to be a pocket player. Mm-hmm. You know, the cat that just lays in there and everybody trusts you because you know that this is so dependable. You're like a rock.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And that's where I get my joy. Because I enjoy seeing people like Victor Wooten and these like phenomenal bass players and stuff. You know,
solo bass players.
Yeah. And that's their choice, which is wonderful. We need them. They're very important because they take the bass to another place.
Yeah, they're the pioneers pretty much.
The pioneers, yeah. You know, that ain't even bass no more to me.
Right.
But you know, like pocket bands, you know, that's what I love. Mm-hmm. I love bands, man. You know, horns.
You done did it all, man.
Yeah,
and I'm interested to know now. So now, so once you saw James Brown, you know who? Did you find out who the backing band was back then?
I had no idea.
Okay, so how did you start? When did you get into the business? You know, where it was you're getting paid for it?
Oh, Earl Van Dyke. Earl Van Dyke is the guy who. After Motown had sort of just kind of packed up,
because
that was my pretty much my source of income is like with Motown. I was doing a ton of sessions that nobody even knew about, you know. I mean, I had a whole week booked with Marvin Gaye over at Studio B, where we had to cut about 50 songs, you know, for a whole week.
Mm-hmm.
And then like years and years later, the stuff comes out after he's dead, you know. But but in any event. My introduction into that, out of high school, there was a group called the Undisputed Truth, Smiling Faces. They needed a bass player, Undisputed Truth. Me and Ricky Lawson and Ricky Rouse, you know, we found out where this rehearsal was and we went down in audition, you know. So I'm down there and I'm like, you know, playing the stuff and everything. And then Norman Whitfield comes down to the rehearsal. Right?
Wow.
So I had no idea who he was. He's a big, light-skinned guy with a great big old fro, you know. But I knew he was somebody important because when he came in, everybody started playing different. You know. But anyway, you know. So Norman came down and then he's just talking. I'm in the room and he says, "Who's the bass player?" And he wouldn't even look at me. he's asking Joe. Said, "Who's the bass player?" I said, "That's Eddie Watkins." You know. So anyway, he leaves. And then his boy comes back down and said, Norman wants to use you on a recording session. Mm. And I'm like, are you kidding me? For who? He said, for the Temptations.
And
I'm like, well, why? I mean, because Jameson is the man, you know. Mm-hmm. And but see, Norman was reaching out to do some different kind of things. He was looking for different sounds other than the typical Motown sound, you know. And Norman was an innovator over there at Motown, you know. So my very first Motown session was for Norman Whitfield and the Masterpiece album for the Temptations. Mm. I was 17 years old.
That's awesome, man.
That is awesome.
And that was where the business started, because now to show you how my luck was, they weren't putting musicians' names on the album covers back then, right?
Right.
Until the Masterpiece album came out.
Wow.
That was the first Motown album where they put musicians' names on it and my name was on there.
And then people could speculate what then Eddie did all them cuts before. Oh, this is the guy who's been playing the bass on all them other cuts.
And I tell you what's funny, man, when somebody comes and asks me, say, you know, don't your father play bass? No, that's me, man.
that's awesome, man.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it just kept going from there, right? I mean, this is your job, bro. Or did you?
Well, no.
Or were you still a paper boy at the time?
Well, no. It kind of took a downturn when Motown left, mm-hmm. and Detroit was like in pretty bad shape. You know, I was like at Mozambique and Casino Royale and Watts. I mean, Henry's mm-hmm. and stuff like that. So, you know, and I had a band, Legacy. That was a really good band, local band. Ricky Rouse, Carl Small, gosh, who else was in that band? Ricky Lawson, Mike Good, Alan Barnes, that went on to play with the Blackbirds. Mm-hmm. But it was a very good band. But what happened for me is, like, when all of that dried up, I needed a job, you know. Mm-hmm. And they weren't hiring bands, you know. OC's had shut down, a lot of the bars had shut down. So I got a call from Earl Van Dyke. He says, "You ready to work?" I said, "Yeah." Because I had a reputation for, like, being late and stuff and kind of, you know. I was a kid, you know.
Right.
And Earl Van Dyke, he called me up. He said, "Are you ready to work now?" Because I had a kid by then. I had a baby, you know. And he said, "You ready to work?" I said, I'm hungry. He said, "I'm going to introduce you to this guy named John Trudell. Do not fuck this up." You know? So I started working for John Trudell with the John Trudell Orchestra, because my reading was like really, really good. So I started playing with John Trudell, and then we ended up at DB's out in Dearborn.
I remember that.
You remember that?
At the top of
DB's. Yeah. Yeah. So I had that gig for like a year. And I was trying to save up enough money to move out to California, you know. So, but during that time, I played behind Soupy Sales, Robert Goulet, Carol Lawrence, Vic Damone.
He's like the TV show
Jerry
people,
right? Lewis. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I played behind a lot of the show acts. And
That's what they used to call A-list.
The A-list acts, yeah.
That's A-list stuff.
Yeah, people like Sarah Vaughan would come through there, but she would carry on rhythm section, you know. But I got exposed to so much music, and the charts were so difficult that by the time I got out to California, you know, I would tell people, they asked me, "Can I read?" I tell them, "A fly can shit on paper, I can turn it upside down and transpose it." A bit of an attitude, you know. Yeah. But I got a lot of work then. And see, the interesting thing about that is, like, all you have to do is play on a couple of gold or platinum records. And these producers, they seem to think that you have something.
You have a formula.
There's something about you.
Yeah,
that
that's the formula. That's all you have to do. X factor.
Yeah.
Of course, he can't understand, you know.
Yeah, yeah. You know, sort of like... So that's how I got on the A-list, is because when I, my first session there was for Paul Reiser, and we did a thing for a guy named Prince Philip Mitchell, and Norman Connors was producing it. And that's how I got into the thing with Norman Connors and who were Phyllis Hyman, Gene Karn, Pharoah Sanders, and his whole crew, you know, that he did. And then from there, I met Bobby Lyle, who introduced me to Wayne Henderson, who was doing all this at-home stuff over here, you know. So we went and did the whole at-home deal.
That's the sax player for Weather Report.
He was a trombone player for the Crusaders.
Oh, Wayne Henderson.
Yeah, yeah.
I was thinking Wayne Shorter, my bad.
Yeah, everything led up from that, but it started from Earl Van Dyke saying, are you ready to work now? I'm going to tell you one thing. This is what you need to do. You got all the talent that you need. You got to work on your attitude, but buy a tux and always be on time. Mm-hmm. That's all you got to do for now, you know.
That's awesome.
And that's what I did, and I learned so much from him, because he was a band leader for Frida Payne. So I traveled with him, me and Earl Jones, the drummer, and
one of the Funk Brothers.
Yeah, and Earl Van Dyke. We were Frida Payne's rhythm section for about a year. You know. So my experience in Detroit is thick. It's like the roots are like so deep from here, you know, through the Motown stuff, and also through like a group I played with called the Dashikis at the drone of bowling alleys.
The Dashikis, that had to be in the 70s, right?
Oh man, it was so in the 70s. You know, we would take a break and go over to Esquire's, you know. And, and then, you know, Dot Netters and all that kind of stuff. That was all. Oh, and the Hobby Bar. The Ebony set, my first band was the Ebony set with Victor Hall and Mike Good, and Ricky Lawson was in that band too.
May he rest in peace at this time.
Oh, Ricky was just, you know, that hit me so hard, man, because, yeah, you know, everybody. We were really, really good buddies.
But you hung on for a little while.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. But that hit really hard, you know.
Man, okay, so, and ladies and gentlemen, he's leaving out a few. I know it's hard to plug yourself, man, but if you can just do it for us, that you leaving out a few people that you did some work with. I think probably some people we never heard of, along with, you know, the name drops like Pattie Labelle, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just drop a few that I might have heard
of. Well, I can tell you something about Pattie Labelle. Is like, you know, I did a couple of projects for her. Produced by David Rubinson up at the Automat in San Francisco. But Pattie Labelle, out of all of the artists that I've ever worked with, I think she was one of the kindest and the sweetest people that you ever want to meet in your life. You know, I mean,
I can tell.
She cooked for the band.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, that kind of stuff, man. You know, it's just like just an absolutely incredible person. You know. But it was her, or Peter Frampton was another interesting.
Yeah, that's a little different.
It was a little different. Yeah. You know, Peter Frampton wanted to do an album that had more funk in it. So he redid Sign, Seal, Delivered and a couple of things. And they wanted to get like, who's the hot session bass player? Say, well, that would be Eddie Watkins. So, bam, you know, I get the call, right? And but it was simply that, you know. The guy that got me entrenched into the sessions was a guy named Ben Barrett. He was the contractor, the big contractor in Los Angeles. And everybody knew this guy, you know. And after Ben Barrett, I think there wasn't anybody that was even close to him. Because he was like the agent mogul out there. We drove a little powder blue Mercedes. Yeah, they looked like Benjamin Franklin. And everybody that knows Ben Barrett, they'll know exactly what I'm talking about, you know. But he kept a lot of us working because he was so connected, you know, with the companies and the producers and stuff, you know. Mm-hmm. But in any event, everything that happened to me. Now I had a conversation with Joe Sample, because I played with them for a while, and we became kind of close during that time. Joe told me, he said that one thing. Because, you know, he came up and saw my band. My band was playing up at Mammoth, and he had a house up there, you know. So he just happened to be up there. He stopped in. He knew I was playing. And we were sitting at the bar, you know, where we usually sat. And Joe was telling me, he said, let me tell you something. That bass, you owe everything to that bass. Everything that you've ever done is because of that bass, and every place that you're going to go is because of that bass. Never forget that, you know. Because I was like singing, and I was like doing all of this other kind of stuff, and we stepping and everything. He said, that's all fine, you know. He said, but you have something that's going to always come back in style. It's that Motown sound, you know, because it's solid and it's true, you know. And you, things are going to shoot off from that, but it's got to come back to that because it's the truth. You know, and I heard him. I understood exactly what he was saying. Well, not exactly. It got clearer as time went on, you know, but I learned a lot of stuff from Joe. I remember one night we were over in Switzerland somewhere. I had been working with the Crusaders for about 6 months. It seemed like I couldn't do nothing right, man. Joe, Wilton, Kess was always on me, man. You know, I mean, I think I have a good night, man. You know, see, but it's always a but, you know. So, man, I was getting so frustrated. And then one night I just decided, I'm just going to go out and play for me. I know these songs back and forth, you know. I went out there and man, I just like let it go. I was just like floating. Came off stage, Joe said, now that's what I'm talking about. You know, I said, I got this now, you know, so I had it down. So the next night, you know, we went out, and I said, I'm gonna nail it again tonight, you know. So I remember what I did last night. This is gonna be cool. And then we came off stage. He said, "What are you doing?" I said, "It worked last night." He said, "That was last night, motherfucker." And then it went into, but you know, that's exactly how he said it. But it went into a whole nother dynamic about when playing music. He said that we're not tracking, man. This ain't tracking. You know, so you may have been a hotshot bass player tracking, you know, but this real music over here, you know, this is jazz. And it's fresh every night. We ain't tracking. You know, so that threw me way out of my comfort zone because my comfort zone was that I could read, that I could play anything, that I was solid, that I could nail this thing, you know, and I light into a pattern, man, I got it, can't nobody play it like this, I'm solid, I'm there, I'm, you know. And when I got with them, it was like, well, all that little stuff that you think you don't, that don't really apply here.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
But it was just what I needed at the time when I thought that I really knew something, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, jazz is something else, man. And the Crusaders was awesome. One of my favorite jazz bands.
I have so much respect for those guys, you know. Just incredible respect for them.
Man, now speaking of tracking, when he say tracking, I believe he's talking about in the studio where he's where you got to duplicate this part and get this part right and
punch this and punch that or whatever.
Take your keys out your pocket and you know all this kind of stuff that's tracking during the studio work.
Yeah.
So what's the difference between playing in the studio and then playing live in these professional settings? What's the difference? If there is one.
Oh God, it's such a big difference. And I can only speak from my perspective, but a live performance, the greatest component of a live performance is the people, you know, because there's an energy there in the audience that you're picking up, and that energy is part of the music, you know, and whether they're standing up, clapping or whatever, it's there. You know, they don't have to be jumping up and down and, you know, throw your hands in the air like you just don't care. They don't have to do that. It's the energy that's there and you feel it, you know. And you're playing with other musicians, you know. You're not overdubbing, you know. It's like certain things you don't even pay attention to anymore because this is live.
Right.
This is live. And it breathes, you know. It's not always the tempo, you know. Some things, it's dynamic. You know, when you're in the studio, your dynamics are going to be very small. You know, because there's only a certain amount of bandwidth, but when you're playing live, you can go like to a blast, to a whisper,
right?
You know, and it's all part of that magic of a live performance, you know. So that's the difference for me. The best scenario is recording live.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Which is something that I would like to do one day, you know.
Okay. You recently had a CD out here, right?
Yeah, I have four.
Okay.
And I started, you know, right now I'm like 19 years between cocktails.
Right? Okay.
So, that was just the 21st of this September. It was 19 years for me.
So, have you been to a bar since? I mean.
Yeah, I've been in bars or whatever, you know. But, the thing is, it's like during that time when I had so much success in L.A., mm-hmm. you know, in the 70s, a lot of other things came along with that experience.
Yeah.
You know, like substance abuse.
I used to think it was mandatory, you know, to be a professional musician, you had to do drugs. I used to think that was mandatory.
In certain circles, it was an advantage.
Yeah.
You know,
it but just was. Baker actually went out there and intentionally became a heroin addict because he thought it would make him sound more like mine.
but anyway, like I said, you know, it led to that part of my life, and in an attempt to get myself back together, I went into a program which required me to find a God of my understanding.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and through that process, I ended up having a spiritual awakening, and then realized what all of these experiences in my life. Before it was for praise and worship, you know. So I've been doing that since 2008.
And as a result, that's when the Eddie Watkins Jr. CD start happening since 2008. So these are spiritual gospel
spiritual,
compositions.
Exactly.
Okay.
And I've been traveling the United States for like. Almost 2 years now, and the way the music is being received is phenomenal, absolutely phenomenal. You know, I mean, I go into these little towns and they treat me like a rock star, man. Mm-hmm. And these are churches, just churches and centers around the country. You know, I've been homeless, you know, like for 2 years, but I have several homes all around the country mm-hmm. that I can go just at any time. You know.
Okay, and so tell us in case we want to go purchase or some of these CDs. This can you just chronologically give us title and artist?
Yeah, the first CD is called The Answer, and that was when I first had my spiritual awakening. So a lot of the songs on there are pretty. There's a song called "God Is All There Is," talking about the journey, the answer. All is well. I'm not worried about tomorrow, but today I declare freedom from yesterday, mistakes of the past. Today all things are made brand new. And don't it feel good to know that all is well and unfolding as it should? That's one of the songs on that. And of course, The Answer, and I've got a few like hits off of that thing. And then the second CD was called We Come Together. And We Come Together is like a congregational opening song that's sung in Unity churches all over the world right now. It's absolutely amazing. It's like from my little, you know, Pro Tools unit. Mm-hmm. I have a song that's being played in churches all over Unity churches all over the world. And then the third CD is called And So It Is, you know, and it's got a song on there called I Fly, God Is So Good, I'm Walking Away. That's a song about walking away from the thinking that's held you for so long, walking away from things that no longer serve you. So those mm-hmm. are the kind of messages that I'm putting to this Motown beat and this music. So for me, it has a different purpose. The Motown has a different purpose to me because it's like a vehicle to get this positive music out to people and these positive lyrics and a positive message about life and reminding people of the power that's within them, you know. And I'm not a minister, and I'm not preaching a religion or anything. I'm just talking about humanity, and you know how we treat each other, you know, how we respect each other, the mm-hmm. planet, you know, that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's what I chose to sing about, you know. So that is my ministry, and that is my dedication right now. And the bass, like Joe Sample said, the bass is what's carrying me through all of this.
Right, and if we wanted to see you perform, what's the name of your gospel group again?
Well, no, I don't have a gospel group. It's just Eddie Watkins Jr. But I have a concert called Motown and Miracles.
On your tour, yeah. Is it just you by yourself?
Well, it depends. A lot of times, I was just in Mile High in Denver. And we had, I guess, about an 8-piece band for the Motown and Miracles concert. And it was phenomenal. We had over 1,400 people, you know. And it was all Motown. I added disco and Beatles for this one. We did it last year, and this year I added disco and Beatles stuff, you know. But again, it's a genre that can help heal the world, I believe.
Okay, and if we wanted to see you, just look for... what do you call the performance or
if you want to see my live performances, you can go onto YouTube and just type in Eddie Watkins Jr. It'll give you more stuff than you want to see.
Okay. Well, we're gonna do that. And I mean, you know, we're being seen in over 150 countries, right, and territories, mm-hmm, and all around the United States. So somebody seeing this right here might say, you know what? I just heard this guy was gonna be here. I'm gonna go check it out. So that's why I want to know EddieWatkinsJr.com or EddieWatkinsJr. Eddie Watkins Jr. on YouTube, right?
Yeah, EddieWatkinsJr.com will take you everywhere. It'll take you to YouTube and Facebook and everywhere.
Okay. Yo, you got a Facebook page too?
Yes, sure do.
That's awesome. I got one too.
And also, you know, I just need to say that you know what you guys have created here with Detroit Bass Player. You know, it's phenomenal. I think it's absolutely incredible, you know.
And that's
thank
only
you. Thank you so much.
That's only because of guys like you, guys like this guy who just Chevy just called out of the blue, man. I'm from New York.
Yeah,
I live in Detroit. I
stumbled across.
I didn't see all the videos, and I know he did because he mentioned stuff that really happened on those videos. Right. And of course, we couldn't do it without this man, because the BASSmint is the bomb. You know what I'm saying? Everybody say the BASSmint is the bomb. Mm-hmm. And just to mention, few people say that door right there. They say that's an alien right there. Look at the top left. Top left hand corner.
Yeah.
They actually say that's an alien. Yeah, I mean, it's so much stuff. So, but again, it couldn't happen without people, bass players like that. Mm. And like that, you know what I'm saying?
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hey, you know, why don't we play something, man?
Well, I have a couple questions first.
Yeah,
okay.
Go ahead.
Out of all of the artists that you've worked with,
mm-hmm,
what is your number one favorite? Or, you know, it could be just from the music that you did with them, or just their overall, you know, you said Pattie Labelle was probably one of the nicest people. Mm-hmm. Or maybe, you know, your top three favorite. Because I know sometimes, you know, with all the people that you've worked with, it could be hard to pick just one. But, you know, who stands out in your mind?
Yeah, some people stand out. Producers really stand out. Freddie Perren is one of the producers that stood out to me. First of all, he's just an incredible guy. But his dedication to production.
Right.
You know, he did, like, you know, some of the Saturday Night Fever stuff. I did Stacey Ladislaw with him, Johnny Gill. I did Gloria Gaynor. He produced I Will Survive. Peaches and Herb did that with him. So I worked a lot with him and was kind of part of his mom and pop's country store family. That was the name of his studio. But he's just such an incredible guy, and you learn from producers like that because they actually know what they're doing.
Right.
You know, Quincy Jones.
You got to work with him too?
Yeah, I worked on Come to Me, on James Ingram, Patty Austin, mm-hmm, Hello Margarita. There's a few songs that I did on that. Every Home Should Have One, I think that was the name of the CD or whatever. Quincy Jones, he blew my concept of tracking out of the water, because when we did Come to Me, he brought a string track that Richard T. had cut in New York. Strings and a click, right? And we overdubbed the entire band on top of strings and a click for Come To Me. It was the weirdest thing I ever saw, man. Because there's nothing but strings. But yeah, John Robinson was on drums. Mm-hmm. Steve Lukather was on guitar. Paul Jackson Jr. Who else was on that thing? God, just... who was on keyboards? David Pace was on keyboards and Greg Fillinganes. So you had these incredible musicians, and the click track went on, the strings went up, and it was just, what? You know, it was amazing. Anyway, that was, and what that taught me is about the quality of the musicians that you use, anything's possible. Mm-hmm. You know, and thinking outside the box, you know, because I would have never thought of, that you could cut a track like that.
Usually the strings is one of the last pieces to come in.
Yeah.
String arrangements and stuff.
Right, right. And another thing, a little footnote about that that some people might find interesting is when we cut Come To Me, it was just a chord chart, you know, so there was no bass part there. So on that part, looking back in time, when I was playing like, dum-dum,
let me hear it. I can't hear you.
Oh, yeah. Okay, I was playing like, looking back in time when I was only in my mind, I realized, that's what I was playing, right? Uh-huh. And then, I was playing, baby, come to me, let me put my arms around, and he said, okay, Watkins, okay, this is good, flip it. Mm-hmm. Flip it around. He said, I want you to play it long during the verses when you hear the long notes in there. But when you're saying, come to me, I want you to bounce, you know. And that's all he told me, man. And then when I listened back to it, I said, makes all the sense in the world, you know.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But, okay, now the other guy would be Hal Davis. Hal Davis from Motown. Hal Davis was part of the Corporation TM that wrote I Want You Back, Love You Safe, ABC, along with Freddie Perren and these guys. So working for him was incredible because I did Diana Ross with him. I did Thelma Houston with him. That's the kind of stuff that he did. And the way Hal Davis was, every session was a party because he had a full bar, you know. Mm-hmm. Paramount Studios is where he recorded. He had a full bar, you know. And it's always me and James Gatson. Who's the guitar player? Like Wawa Watson. He loved Wawa Watson and Ray Parker. And we were the guys that he would always use. And so, yeah, so Hal Davis, he was, one of the most incredible producers for me because he didn't have the musical education, but he was just a soul man. Mm-hmm. Soul, and that was, wear a little engineer's hat, man. But those are the guys that I would say. Really, and James Brown, working with James Brown was a trip too.
You know? Yeah, I'm sure it was. Yeah. Just for what I see on TV, I just imagine that was a fun time with.
And Barbra Streisand, that was. She was a very powerful, talented, deep individual. You know, you could feel her power when you walk in the studio. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, what about bass players? And when I asked, I noticed you mentioned Jamerson as an influence, mm-hmm. but you can combine influences and guys you like to listen to. If you like this,
yeah, Peter Cetera.
From then to now, you know,
Peter Cetera was very instrumental in my style because first of all, I was in love with Chicago. And but his style was so melodic and free, you mm-hmm. know. Jamerson was melodic but pocket, mm-hmm. you know. And Peter, you know, the Saturday at the Park, he was just taking it and then like.
Yeah, me too. Chicago was the bomb.
Yeah, so Peter Cetera and his melodic playing, just like 25 or 6 to 4, stuff like that. the bass playing was so free and melodic, and I loved that. So, you know, I adapted a lot of that into my style as well. Okay. Bass players for me, I like Victor Wooten a lot, Stanley Clarke a lot, Jaco a lot. I would have to say one of my favorites would have to be Marcus Miller. Mm-hmm. For the same reason as the pocket, mm-hmm. you know. There's a lot of guys. I saw a guy, I think his name was Ed Vega or...
Bobby
Vega. I saw a video on him the other day and it just blew me away, man.
Yeah, that pocket funk that he did.
Ooh, man. He was
tight.
But, also, he's...
Larry Graham.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Originator of thumping and plug. There ain't no such thing as slap and pop. It's thump and plug.
Okay.
Larry Graham. Mm-hmm. And Bobby Vega, a BASSmint alumni. We're going to be putting up his interview in the BASSmint.
Yeah.
The day that they released the November issue of Bass Player Magazine, because Bobby Vega did a nice little piece on Detroit bass players in the Bass Player Magazine. So when the issue was out for subscribers, but once they released the issue to the public, that's the day we're gonna release his interview here in the BASSmint.
Okay,
and he's looking for Bobby's the bad man, did Tower Power Sly Stone and a couple of and he, like you, once y'all get the plan that y'all can't, that for some reason that leg get the shaking, man. That's that passion for that thing make you do that. That thing you hold make you do that,
that's
man. Right,
that's a piece of wood.
Yeah. And speaking of that,
yes.
What kind of bass is that, man? I can't see.
Mustang.
A Fender Mustang.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cause I know it kind of looked like a Fender, but then it kind of didn't. I didn't know what it was. It's a Mustang.
It was different.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a Mustang. Average White Band played a Mustang.
Now, is this your main piece, or do you play multi-instruments? I mean, do you have multiple basses?
Multiple Fenders, yeah. I got two jazz basses. One is a Mexican jazz bass I rebuilt, and the other one's like a standard jazz bass.
So I got a Mexican jazz, too.
I've seen some of your stuff on your page.
For those who hadn't seen it, you got about just Fenders? You the Fender man, huh?
Yeah, I actually was Guitar Center about a week ago, like trying out basses. I tried Yamaha, and what's the other one? Ibanez. And see, I like the sound that you know, the cats are getting now with the electronics and everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's easier to play. It records really good. It's the neck. For me, bass is all about the neck for me. And then if I can get a neck that I like, I'll rebuild the bass.
Okay, now what is it in the neck that you like? The fretboard maple or the type of wood it is or what?
It's totally how it feels in the hand.
You just have an ergonomic.
Yeah.
So it's just based on feel alone.
It's totally based on feel.
Right, and I tell people that what feels good.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
That's what you need to.
Yeah, give me something to feel good, then tell me what it is.
Exactly.
Okay, that's okay, whatever. You know, I understand that you know, people who are really, really smart and they know how to pick wood to get a certain sound and all that kind of stuff, which is very cool, you know.
Any custom basses for you? Have you ever had one built? Anybody?
Yeah.
Anybody approach you for it?
Not anybody approached me, but I had a Fender custom built back in the early 80s. And as a matter of fact, that's the precision that I'm playing on the Crusaders videos and stuff. It's mm-hmm. that old, I had a Badass too, Seymour Duncan's, gold-plated bridge and all, you know, just ivory. Up here, you know, all that kind of stuff.
And then those were personal requests.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Okay, but you ain't like, you're not a elect engineer as far as I need humbucking EMGs, pickups, and with double coil.
I wouldn't even know what that was. I'm like, humbugging.
Yeah, I'm just throwing words at that. I don't have a clue. If somebody asked me what I want in the bass, I like.
Does it sound good?
I like that. Make it like this Fender. Well, I already got this Fender, so what's the point? You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, I would need guidance on my own custom bass, so that's why I just threw some names out there.
Yeah.
But man, look, I heard you about, let's play something. I ain't want to keep you, but I did want to know if anybody else had any questions before we
let
you go, man.
Yeah, I did. I just want, let me see. Well, you said you were 17 when you were playing with the 10th Hut. Let me see, what year was that?
Let me see. I'll be 60 on the 27th of this month.
2 years younger than me. But so, you know, I was 13, I started playing. And when I was 14, we did. Do you remember a group from Detroit called the Tempton Five? They was like Temptations impersonators, but they had it down.
Oh, yeah.
And it was
the Tempton Five.
The Tempton Five.
I never heard of
the Tempton Five. So I played with them, man. And I got a face full of what it was like, because them girls went crazy. They was all over us. And the same girls I went to school with. And I said, I'm going to have to do this one again.
I didn't know you was an imitation temptation.
Yeah, man. Robeson High School. Was it 1966 or something like that? But I was going to ask you, what was that like, man, playing with the Temptations at 17?
For me, it wasn't that glamorous because, you know, I was in the studio.
Okay.
You know, and when I did, I went on the Temptation, went with them on tour. Not on tour. I did a gig with them in Ohio, right? And you know, the band drove. The hotel was terrible. and we played and everything. And of course, did the Temptations. You know, of course. But none of that was for me.
Yeah. Right.
You know, that was for them.
After, before and after the gig, they probably asked you, who are you? To get in the gig, probably they had to have your instruments with you, huh?
Well, it's the thing is, like, when you work with the Temptations, it's such a massive overflow, you know, that, you know, everybody's, I mean, you know, that's how it is.
That's funny, though. You said y'all drove to Ohio, huh?
Yeah, we drove.
That's the kind of tours I used to do for real. I drove to every one of the we played every weekend. I had to drive to every last one of them.
That's
awesome, man. Any more questions, Chevy?
Do your basses extend past four strings?
No, I like the idea of the five strings, and I've played a couple before, but See, you know, the thing is, I don't really play bass that much no more, man. You know, I make more money singing.
Right.
That's just how it is, you know. But when it comes to writing and putting my tracks together, you know, this is the anchor right here.
Right.
You know, this is even the songs. You know, when I build a song, it's from the bass up. You know, that's just how it is. You know, but no, it doesn't extend past five strings for me.
Okay.
Although I like that low sound.
It
sounds real manly. You know, it's like you know.
Right.
I like that, of course. You know.
Right.
Man, like I said, I didn't want to keep you. Before you play us out, is there anything you like to say in closing? It don't matter what it is, you know.
Yeah. Well, you know, if I may get a little metaphysical on you, you know, the thing is, it's like, you know, whenever you picked, the first time you picked up your instrument and you felt like this was the thing that you loved and you wanted to do for the rest of your life, you know, you never have to let go of that feeling, you know. And it could be about as you get older and you have family and children, whatever, you know, whatever your reason is, whatever your path may be, you know, in life. That's a gift if you have a burning desire in your heart to play music, you know. And that is the thing that's going to keep you young until you take your last breath, you know. So do not let anybody tell you what you can't do, because they don't know, because they don't know you, you know. Anything is possible when you believe.
That is so true.
Yeah.
I've seen it happen to many of folks.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. You know, I mean, look at me. I mean, I've had like three careers already. And I'm going strong, you know. And I mean,
That's beautiful, man.
And I feel really good about life, and I'm looking forward to the next 10, 15 years.
Okay. You
know? Do what you love. You know, do what you love.
Yeah, I had to wait until I retired to start doing what I love.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but look at what it's showing, though. Look at your demonstration.
I don't have any regrets about it.
Yeah.
I put the career on hold so I could be a parent.
Yeah.
I only had one child that already lost one. I said, oh, no.
Yeah.
Okay, let with this one.
That's why I say 50 is the new 17.
Yeah, I was kidding. All right, what cool. 62 is the new what?
The 18.
Oh, is that what it is? Yeah. I'm 18 now?
Yeah.
Well, I know. I would really like to hear that. Anything is possible when you believe.
It's evident. It's evident. I've seen it happen over and over again.
But that's one of his songs.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
The name of one of your songs is If You Believe? Got a video for it?
Yeah.
Can we hear it? Now?
Like I said, I don't want to keep you, so why don't you just play us something now? And your sister recommended that you play Anything Is Possible If You Believe.
Well, that's the title to my new CD is When You Believe.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Eric Watkins, a Detroit bass player, hanging out with us, even though he lives in Florida.
It's possible when you believe. Anything is possible when you believe. Faith can make a mountain move when you believe. Faith can make a mountain move. Don't you know that you can change a life when you believe? Don't you know that you can change a life when you believe in yourself?
When you believe
in yourself.
When you believe
in yourself.
When you believe
in yourself.
When you
ladies and gentlemen, Eddie Watkins Jr.